Okay. Can everyone hear me? Hey, all right. We're about to get started. Thank you, everyone, for coming out tonight. Welcome to the AILA events on AI and the future of work. Give yourselves a hand. My name is Ross Mead. I am the Vice President of AILA. I've been involved with this and with Todd for the past 3 years since we've conceived this crazy idea of bringing this community together. I won't give the whole vision of AILA. Todd will talk more about that. But I first just wanted to come up here and thank our fantastic contributors who have been helping us for years and years and years, really trying to get this off the ground and really build up this community into what it is today and what it will continue to be going into the future years. So I wanted to thank Jorge. Are you in the room? Jorge's back there. Arturo is right there, and Charlie, who's helping us with the AV tonight. Thank you so much, guys. As well as other contributors who are helping us actually on stage, and Todd will talk more about her. Laura, that's Laura there. And we want to thank our sponsors as well, so Google for having us here. Kluge Interactive, which is Arturo's group, who's doing really awesome design work, and go talk to him. He'll get you started on cool design stuff. And my company, Semio, but I'm not here to promote that. What I am here to promote right now is Todd, actually. So he never gets enough love because he's busy making all this happen and he can't talk about himself. So I'm going to talk about himself. So Todd busts his ass to make this all happen, okay? So this is what he does all day, every day. He makes this happen. Show the guy some love. He loves this. He loves the community. He loves you guys. I'm going to hand the mic off to him. So this is Todd Terrazas. Thank you, Todd.
Hey, everybody. Thank you, Ross. We got into this whole like hype guy thing, and I loved it. Normally, I just start talking, and anyways, thank you all for coming out. Look at this. This is beautiful. Thank you for Google seriously inviting us back, and we'll be back here next month, too, talking about creating a fair and ethical future. Again, none of this is possible without you. You're the ones that really drive us to actually, you know, build this community and actually want to do good, be a better version of ourselves. Seriously, I mean, what other amazing free event have you ever been to where you get to have, you know, access to Google, great conversations, amazing food? Who here ate the, did you understand it was vegan food, right? That sexy lunch club. They're one of our amazing partners. Thank you, Ryan. That mac and cheese actually is not real cheese, but damn, is it good. On top of that, we have Purity Organic. They've been amazing from constantly, I swear, I don't even know how many months they've been donating their products, but Purity Organic. One Hope Wine's been a great supporter of ours. Hope you like enjoy the wine. One Hope Wine is a good supporter of ours. GT Kombucha. Ozunia Tequila, if you have one of their margaritas tonight, they're pretty delicious. The Dews Brewery. Tend, our bartenders, they have been donating their time for us tonight. So thank you to our bartenders. Seriously, everyone. Within the family is Kluge, Arturo, we were talking about before, Kluge Interactive. They are a B2B tech consulting and design agency. They are pretty amazing. They just launched their new health initiative. So if you are in healthcare in any sort, or really just any type of B2B company, please check out Arturo Perez's company, Kluge. They're pretty amazing. They've helped our organization really workshop exactly where our vision, what our vision is, what our 5, 10, 20-year plan is, and that's how we really keep focused. And then, of course, Ross Mead, our vice president, Kluge. Sorry, not Kluge, Semio, I just said that. And Semio is developing the operating system for robotics. So, you know, really Ross is the one that legitimizes the whole AILA community because he has a PhD in computer science and human interaction social robotics. And so he's definitely hiring developers. So if you're into JavaScript or machine learning or really just want to, you know, be part of a really amazing company from the beginning, please look at Ross. Hang out with Ross later. But what I was really interesting is this. So I was having a lunch with a good friend of mine who just sold his company to AT&T, and he's a big marketer. And he was talking to me about when he first started out building his company. And one of his first clients was Coca-Cola. And he said in the very beginning, this is the beginning days of social media, and the first slide he had was that, if you love yourself enough, will you stop talking about yourself? And it was really interesting. But he said that's what got him that client. And I really believe that, you know, any brand out there, it's not about what the brand says about itself, it's what a friend tells a friend. So if you really want to, you know, improve your career, improve your business, or improve your relationships in general, I believe you should support your community. And so with that, I mean, we really are really, really grateful to be here. We're grateful to have this amazing panel and everything else about it. So without really plugging, whoa, how does this work? Without plugging anything, we obviously, there's suggested donations. We are a California nonprofit pursuing our 501c3 status. So hey, if you feel generous, there's a Venmo at the bar, there's a credit card machine. So in any way, if you really want to help us out, please let us know. We're looking for more volunteers, trust me. It takes a village to do what we do here. I'm like, you know, just executing on certain things, but in the background, Jorge is the one that created our beautiful logo. He creates all the different graphics that we have. Charlie in the background, he's been taking photography, taking all the photos. He's been taking videos that we'll be using for a recap video. He's even right now live streaming this to Facebook. So, trust me, this takes a village. We are a community. Look around you. This is beautiful. Now, can we all actually look at each other and maybe give a high five to the person next to you? Let's give high fives out. Woo! That's love. That's love. Now, who here is looking for a job? Who here is looking for a job? All right. Now, who here is hiring? Not put you on the spot, but who here is hiring, right? Look around you. This is your community. You get what you put into it. Whether you're trying to find a new job, a new client, you know, a new partner, love, whatever you want, right? You'll find it in this community. So anyways, I'm done with my spiel, but it gives me great pleasure to introduce to you one of my good friends, an advisor of AILA community, one of our contributors who wrote a Medium article for us around the future of work, and your moderator, our moderator, Lara Jamko. Thank you.
Thank you, Todd. Well, I'm so excited to be here. I want to say hello to our live stream viewers. We have an amazing conversation planned for you. Each one of these individuals on the stage has a really unique perspective, and the topic of future of work is so enormous and so expansive, so we'll have a lot to discuss and time for Q&A at the end, so be thinking all along what you want to ask. I run an advisory and investment firm called Beyond Ventures, and I focus on the intersection of technology, science, and entertainment. And AI is a big focus of mine. Maybe it's my hair in the way. I want to let each of the panelists introduce themselves tonight. So if you could just give a little bit of a background on yourself, and what I want to know is, what was your first job?
So I guess I'll start.
Yeah.
My name's Joe Rogers. I'm the founder of Work Done. We are a corporate memory digital workforce company that basically improves people's lives by watching them work and then doing the work for them. My first job,
yes,
was selling bicycle parts at the Orange County swap meet.
Thank you.
I had to get up early.
So my name is Vivian Ming. I do a lot of things. I started my career as a theoretical neuroscientist. So arguably my first job was building a real-time lie detection system for the CIA off of raw video. And later we were able to take the same technology and build it into Google Glass. It could read people's facial expressions for our autistic kids to learn how to read facial expressions. And then we built a system for the UN that could reunite orphan refugees with extended family members by modeling their faces. So a little morally gray doing a research project for the CIA, but being able to turn it into something that literally saved people's lives kind of got it addictive. So that's why I'm still in machine learning.
Kyle?
So I'm Kyle. Oh.
I assure you, I don't merit it, but thank you.
I'm Kyle Jackson, founder of a company here in LA called Talespin. We have been working on the kind of future of work problem since 2014, 2015. The fundamental thesis for starting the company was looking at all the forces that were disrupting work from AI, robotics, automation, and changing values of the next generations, and looking at how we needed to redesign the workforce lifecycle and start to embed a lot of new systems into the career models and the organizational planning for large companies. So we've been doing that now since 2015. It's been a really wild ride. We focus basically using spatial computing as the medium to change all this. So it's VR, mixed reality, and augmented reality infused with intelligence. And first job, oh my gosh, mowing yards.
Nice.
At 12.
Hi everyone, I'm Kian Gohar. I'm founder and CEO of Geolab, which is an innovation studio here in LA. We help large companies design and build moonshot innovation strategies and digitally led businesses. I spent the better part of a decade working at the XPRIZE Foundation here in Culver City, helping design futuristic moonshots. And I started getting involved in the future of work as I thought about the impact of AI and automation on society, and spent about a year and a half on a national task force with several governors and cabinet ministers, cabinet secretaries, thinking about how to design governing policies to develop the American workforce. My first job, I had two jobs the same summer, and both of them have been automated now. One of them was I made salad at soup plantation in front of the first line that people came in. And then I also worked as a bank teller, which as you all know has been increasingly gone away as well.
Thank you, Kian. My first job was lifeguarding in upstate New York at a municipal pool, not automated yet, but it was mostly just yelling at kids not to run and having squirt gun fights, so it was pretty great.
Although I do believe that there are probably 24 companies building AI systems to monitor pools now.
Oh, really? Okay. All right. Well, I stand corrected.
Yeah, not for long.
So to kick us off for our conversation tonight, it'd be great to hear from each of you. What was your catalytic moment that drew you in to care about the future of work on a personal level? Anyone can start.
Well, I'll start. So I've spent the last over 20 years consulting in the enterprise content management space and business process management space, re-engineering large insurance companies, banks, governmental institutions, US, Middle East, Southeast Asia. And I've seen the insides of a lot of companies. And I used to see these billboards saying, oh, you know, you don't have to worry about running out of money if you're retired, or like losing your job if you're retired. I'm thinking, who's going to be who's building the software that's automating these jobs away? And I was on a consulting project learning about machine learning separately when I had this aha moment on as to how I could automate myself as a consultant. And that kind of led to work done. And that really, I came to realize that my entire career has led me to this point. And it started out with some technological innovation as far as, you know, using ML to observe and then predict, and I came to realize it would free up a lot of people to do higher value work, but then I also realized it would put a lot of people out on the street. So I struggled with that for a bit, and actually set up the company as a public benefit corp with a percentage of revenue to fund a nonprofit to assist workers displaced by automation to find their next area of vitality, whatever that might be.
Sure, I'll speak. I spent many years helping advise large companies on the future around AI and machine learning, and I came to the conclusion after many years of research that the future of work is really around creativity and not productivity. But I'd be on stage a lot talking about this and helping companies learn about that. And I said, well, if I really believe that, why don't I actually put my money where my mouth is? And so I ended up leaving the role that I had a year ago and went on a year-long journey to understand what creativity really meant around work. And so I've just been really fascinated about what does that mean and how can we teach people this level of creativity so that they can be successful in the future.
Sure, I'll dive in. So, you know, I didn't intend to get into this space. As an academic, I was a theoretical neuroscientist. So we use machine learning to study the brain. We study the brain to come up with new algorithms. Arguably, I don't know whether the world is supposed to thank us or not, but deep neural networks largely came from Jeff Hinton's lab researching these sorts of questions. I have no idea why anyone else deserves any credit for deep neural networks than Jeff. So we did that, and then I had a joint position at Berkeley and Stanford, and my wife and I had an idea to start a company around education. So this is before Coursera or Khan Academy. But we wanted to do something with AI in education, and it felt not like an experiment, it felt like a startup. And so we launched this, and it isn't the details of the education work that we did, but rather what it led to eventually, which was a few years later, I ended up the chief scientist of a company called Guild. So Guild was a sourcing company. We created a big database. At the time, it was big. Nowadays, it's chump change. But it was 122 million people. Google was a customer of ours, and Facebook, and Citibank, and kind of everybody else. And we were using large-scale data sets and machine learning to go out and crawl through the web and figure out who you should hire. All the people you wouldn't have hired, what do they look like? Now, there's a big story to be told there. How does it tie into the future of work? Well, I was the chief scientist of one of the first companies doing AI at a large scale in work. And we were looking at what actually predicted, like, who are the software developers that Google should hire, the salespeople? Well, frankly, that Google should hire, since that's where your money comes from. And it turned out they are people that had virtually the exact same qualities. It wasn't that you knew how to program that made you someone that Google wanted to hire as a programmer. That was like almost a secondary consideration. And same thing on the sales side. It was these deeper qualities about people. And so I've gotten to give TED Talks and write papers about this. The reason it ties in here is we started looking more and more at what comes next. What is it that was actually predictive of everybody, whatever your background, of the people that did the best work, and that we should all really be hiring? And it certainly fits with the story of creativity. We often say it's creative, adaptive problem solvers. The specifics of what you know how to do doesn't really matter that much. It's that you have those qualities. It's that you can learn to learn. And then the reason this comes up again is, well, being the first chief scientist in one of these companies, people started calling me at the White House and newspapers, and because no one else had that scale of data and the sort of insights we had. So I'm someone that builds AI and also studies people. So they started sending me these future of work reports. Like every major government now has a future of work study. Every major organization, all the big consultancies, all the nonprofits, the NGOs, the World Bank, World Economic Forum, they're all garbage. It's just astonishing to me. I could go on about what I mean. I realize I've rolled on a little too long already.
We can come back to garbage.
I hope we come back
to
garbage.
We will come back to garbage.
But that's sort of how I got into this, was sort of walking backwards. I was really trying to build cyborgs. Cyborgs led to education. Education led to workforce. Turns out I'm back to cyborgs now. But I think everyone's thinking about the future of work like dramatically wrong. asking really useless questions like, is this another industrial revolution, and will it create more jobs than it destroys? Turns out the answer to those questions aren't particularly interesting and aren't the ones that are really going to define what comes next. We'll leave it all as fun
teaser.
For further conversation.
Teaser. Kyle.
So I had two kind of events. So I started my career in media entertainment because I believed that my goal was to use the most powerful medium to affect change. And at the time, growing up, that was you know, film and you know, large scale media projects. And so for about 15 years, worked through the industry, working on hundreds of projects and all sorts of different technological innovations along the way. I got kind of dragged into basically the sensor forefront and revolution work and workflow forefront from a tech side. So, in about 2009, we got brought. I was working on merging the physical and virtual worlds in real time for the purposes of producing things like Avatar. And got exposed, you know, to kind of the power of what was going to be possible with real-time engines and what was going on that side of the thing. And I went, this is interesting. This is going to shift the relationship between storytelling and communication and a lot of things over the next, you know, 10 to 15 years. And at that point, I went, okay, I'm done with linear, and it's all real-time, and it's all conversational. In terms of how we need to deliver whatever our message is. And at the time, that was obviously a story message. But so at the same time, I started spending a lot of time up north and started investing in seed stage AI startups in 2011, 2012, and saw just you know, a wave of trends, that all of which were like, okay, this is going to change a lot of important facets of work and facets of people's lives, and we need to start to look at a systematic redesign that can stem some of the more negative predictions that people like to talk about. And so it was a confluence of those two things. And I went, okay, well, you know, here's an opportunity with the change in medium that came with XR and or VR, AR, mixed reality, to basically do something starkly different. And we went, okay, that's something that basically nobody has a preconceived notion of in the corporate world. And we can use that endpoint to essentially start to have a conversation that's just fundamentally different.
This is like BoJack Horseman, we'll scan your face and we'll add your entire performance in post?
We can do that.
Yes.
Yeah, we can do that. We actually have that pipeline, but yeah.
Well, you know, we heard about some of the negative predictions, we heard about potentially garbage data, and, you know, when it comes to the topic of future of work at large, you know, it is a pretty charged issue because it does affect all of us. And there is a lot of coverage in the media, some positive, some negative. But I'd like to hear from the group what most concerns you. Let's start there. Let's just hit the negative head on. Do you want to start, Kian?
Sure. I think actually what concerns me most is the state of culture that we have in this country that doesn't prioritize education and learning as some other countries do. And when I think about 30 years into the future, there are countries like China, elsewhere, that are very much focused on learning, and their cultures constantly are focusing on how do we learn all the time. And I'm concerned about how America might fall behind because we don't have the same culture of learning in terms of traditional learning. So I hope that we develop alternative learning models that will allow our country to thrive over the next generation. That's really what concerns me most, is sort of how do we upgrade our educational system to make sure that everybody in society is learning quickly. That, I think, is really, really critical.
You know, I was invited to this crazy thing. Reid Hoffman and James Manyika, who's the head of research at McKinsey, and Eric Schmidt. So it's like this murderer's row of billionaires, and then a bunch of politicians that are all have received their donations. And
I like her.
We were taking an hour to figure out how to save the shrinking middle class. I mean, in retrospect, I think another 15 minutes and we'd have had it. but the thing was, you know, I was like one of the first people. I leaned over to one of the billionaires next to me. Have you ever felt like you were a few dollars short of the ticket price for this room? That guy does good work. But so we... It was Chatham House rules, so I can't say the specifics, but I was up first, and I'm an education person. In fact, my wife runs research for the San Francisco school system, and I've had a couple of ed tech companies. And I said, it's education. I mean, what do you mean, save the shrinking middle class, if we're not talking about broadly about education? And they're like, we'll figure it out. It's entrepreneurship. In fact, the story is you cannot save the shrinking middle class, and the only thing that will even mitigate it is entrepreneurship. So one of my proudest moments of my life was lecturing Eric Schmidt for 5 minutes that he didn't know a fucking thing about entrepreneurship.
Overheard at AILA.
Yeah.
It's clear that that didn't happen to him very often.
Let's see. So what concerns I'll talk about a different journey. So we've been, so since we started down this road, I got brought into a lot of C-suite rooms and boardrooms where companies, especially legacy companies, insurance companies, automotive companies, telecom, where they're looking at, you know, workforces of 150, 250,000 people. And looking at kind of how do they redistribute that workforce towards the products and the services they're going to provide, and how do they basically cross-skill, upskill, find and attract and assess and all the things that need to go into figuring that out. And I think the thing that was kind of like the first time it happened, it was like, that's a weird comment. And then the second or third or fourth time you started to hear the same comment was all around the notion of basically heavily investing in automation and AI because they could not find the talent and they could not figure out the people problem. Not because they didn't want to. It was because they basically looked at the trend lines and they went, okay, we're screwed. We are not gonna be able to deliver our service because we cannot find the talent to come into these industries to help to provide and backfill the jobs of the people that are leaving. So therefore, let's accelerate our investments in everything else. And so that was an interesting, like, oh, interesting, that's that the conversation that's going on is actually about one leading the other, and then I'm sitting in these rooms where it's actually the opposite. It's actually about values driving and forcing people in a different direction to be able to continue to deliver the service while they figure out what the heck the next service is. And then meanwhile, they don't even have those people to figure that out either. So they're like, we're screwed, how do we deal with this, and what is our future self? And it's like a really interesting. And these, you know, it's been now a half a dozen of those kinds of conversations. Some of the largest companies in the U.S. So it's you know, it's an interesting two-way conversation there that was not expected. I was kind of going in with the naive approach of like, okay, you know, this is going to basically be robotics are going to come in and start to push people out, and we're going to have a shrinking middle class or all the other things that you read, and then you get in, and it's actually at least my experience has been it's quite different than that.
Sure.
We saved the best for last. Yeah.
Such good comments. For me, like the negative aspect is like obviously the fear that surrounds all of this, and it really depends where you're looking at it. It's there's a micro and a macro. It's like economics. And that consulting client where I kind of had the idea, it turned into a work done client. The lady who was sort of going to be affected by this as we were going ready to go live, she slowed down, she slow walked everything, and it turned into this sort of a very political situation. And it impacted our ability to deploy because she all of a sudden got worried about her job. And the CEO of the company told her that her job was not going away. But it was this whole thing, like, wait a second, you know, and she's probably in her early 50s, I guess. So there's a change management issue at a micro level. And then at a macro level, it's, you know, the attitude towards education, I mean, it's, I'm a capitalist, I'm an American, I love my country. We've been sitting, you know, resting on our laurels for way too long. And there are other countries on the planet that actually have like cohesive strategic plans around AI, like a national AI plan that includes the private sector and education towards, you know, domination. And like, we're like squabbling over stuff. So I'm concerned about that.
Mm-hmm. So I want to echo a few things that have come up here, but I think the talent gap one is a really interesting one. So there's this phenomenon that I call the AI bait and switch, which is imagine how AI is going to come in and make everyone better. It's going to augment all of us and make us wonderful. So before you think I'm a Luddite or something, all I do is spend my time building AI things to make people better. So I totally believe in that as a possible future. That's why it's such a good bait. Then there's the switch, which is I get brought in around the world to do briefings for boards and giant companies. And you probably don't know that much about me, but if you did, you would know that the last thing I'm there to do is to put people out of a job. And so they listen to me talk about my opinions of the future of work. I call them opinions, but I'm always right about everything. I'm just being generous to the other panel members here. So I get brought in, I do my little spiel, and they say, I get it. We need to focus on education. We need to worry about the talent gap and the creativity gap, and we need to have a plan. So can you build a chatbot that replace all the tellers at our bank? And you think, what the fuck is wrong with you people? Like, first off, you know, this, I'm talking particularly banks in Asia and Africa who have a legitimate existential threat from Alipay and Tencent. They're just eating their consumer banking industry. And they'll end up probably doing it here, and if they don't, it'll be Google Wallet and Apple Pay. And I'm like, you're gonna go head to head with two of the biggest tech companies in the world in a tech fight? And you're gonna file all of your employees that actually have the local regional knowledge of your company, they know why people would come bank here. And plus, keep in mind, you're almost certainly gonna be buying technology from those same competitors. Who do you think's gonna win that fight? So we keep coming back to a bunch of models of what the future of work will be like, which tends to be something like C-3PO tapping you on the shoulder and saying you're fired. We talk a lot about self-driving cars. I can say this, Uber tried to hire me as their chief scientist, so now officially with their IPO. You could not pay me $10 million to be alone in a room with Travis Kalanick. We're worried about self-driving cars, putting taxi drivers out of work. We're worried about automation and warehouses, putting warehouses out of work. I also was recruited to be the chief scientist for Amazon to do very much the same thing. I think what we really need to worry about, because the sweet spot, I don't know how many of you here have an AI company you're doing or what we're talking about here, but the sweet spot for this stuff is the professional middle class, because the professional middle class is expensive. It is a giant bottleneck. Their expert decision-making process is a giant bottleneck inside companies, and it is perfect for machine learning to disrupt. Whether this is reading contracts to find the loopholes, reviewing a resume to decide whether this person should be brought in for an interview, it doesn't tell you what to do about the loopholes, but just that basic processing, reading, looking at an x-ray to see whether or not this little anomalous blob is actually something cancerous or not. Like, you had to go to school for years and years to do that, and you got paid a lot, and we've been there for a long time. There isn't a good business in building robots to pick strawberries. We might do it just because we're running out of people that are willing to do such a backbreaking labor. It would actually be a human good. But again, what do you do with all these people? I think what we're looking at is actually the professional middle class getting broadsided. And it's not just here. It will be the entire middle class industry that's been built up in India. A huge middle class has been built up in China, throughout Europe. Like, this is the basis of our political systems, our economy. What I'm worried about isn't whether AI creates jobs. I think it creates lots of jobs. Lots of jobs across a massive divide, a creative economy and a service economy. A low wage, low autonomy, low agency service economy, and this wonderful creative economy. Well, you just heard, we're not finding enough people to fill those jobs already. we're not changing our education system, we're not changing our hiring systems, and we're gonna create more jobs? Do we think people, just because they don't have a job, will like magically self-actualize and become scientists and artists? if that's true, there's a line in front of every library around the world, and I have not seen it yet. I'll put it another way. If any of you is a parent, is your job simply to take the boring work out of your child's life, and that's it? Like, then they become an amazing person? So this is the kind of stuff I'm worried about people selling, is we're gonna automate all this stuff, this boring stuff you don't wanna do, and you'll be able to go do all this amazing creative work. You'd already be doing it if that was in your wheelhouse. That is not a trivial thing to make an amazing person. I think everyone can be amazing. But that takes a massive commitment of education, takes a massive commitment and investment in industry to change the kind of work that's going on so that people can be creative. What's the point of hiring talented, creative people and then telling them what to do? Well, our whole industry is based around like Six Sigma and stupid bullshit like that. So I realize this is a very creative town here, but this is the sort of thing, I know I'm talking too much, I'm sorry. I've been on the road for a long time in front of a lot of audiences, and some motherfucker groped me at the Dulles airport last night. By the way, related issue to the future of work is everyone that thinks that the problem with AI right now is it's being built by a bunch of unethical engineers that don't understand AI. Like, because you guys are interested in AI, you are inherently somehow amoral. This guy studied religion at Princeton. The guy who felt me up at the airport. Turns out all those ethics classes in business schools, they don't seem to be doing a lot of good. So there.
Vivian also has a stand-up show on Friday. Hollywood.
I promise I will shut up for a little while.
Yeah, right, yeah. You're in the penalty box for a moment. So there's a lot in that, and thank you. And I know it's been touched on a lot of themes that have come up. I think one that we should tackle next is this concept of training and education and how we value education. And there certainly seems to be a disconnect. In terms of affordability to accessibility of education, the practical ability of people while they're working to try to reskill in something else when they're just trying to put food on the table and roof overhead. What have you all seen that works in training, and what do you think needs to change? And let's start with you, Joe.
Sure. So my undergrad was in computer science at Harvard, and straight out of the gate, I was self-employed. I recently, considering that I was starting a machine learning startup, I should probably learn something about it. So I actually took the Coursera machine learning class, Andrew Ng, and it was the first time that I actually did a course online. And I'd seen Khan Academy and all sort of the micro-learning stuff. It was absolutely, I mean, there was like differential calculus that like, oh my God, it was like spraying WD-40 on a rusty bolt. Like, oh, wait a second. But it was great. I actually read something recently. In the old days, it was one-way communication, and we had the institutions of knowledge, and you went through and you received. Now it's two-way. It just doesn't make a whole lot of sense to spend a ton of money to get a degree when you can get it online while you're working, and it's like, you know, learning on demand, sort of these nano degrees. So I think that's all changing, and you know, so there are some colleges that are going out of business as a result of that. I mean, it's happening. Mm-hmm. So it's with the shift to a gig economy, I mean, it's only going to continue. And I wanted to say that yes, there are people who have been working in an office or, you know, salaried gigs for decades who have never thought about entrepreneurship, but if you're out of work for 6 months and you can't find a job doing what you were doing, you're gonna be thinking, hey, you know, maybe I should And say you have a wood shop in your garage. That's what you actually enjoy doing on your weekends. Maybe you should try to monetize that.
Figure out that actually impacts the Census Bureau tracks entrepreneurship in terms of choice versus circumstance, because it turns out it's a big difference in how people engage in that. But, you know, as someone that went through gender transition, it turns out entrepreneurship is full of people that no one would hire, so they just had to go do it themselves. Or you're like me, you are otherwise unhireable anyways, so my favorite definition of entrepreneurship. But you're right. There is an amazing path, and I think the spirit of what, you know, these guys were saying, guys with fancy smancy degrees and the right skin color and gender and everything, that they never had to worry about it in their lives. But they're right that kind of creativity broad. So not just the creativity of the arts, but the creativity of entrepreneurship, the creativity of engineering. These things are fundamental and transformational in people's lives. But sometimes, you know, the heart of, I've actually been listening to a screenwriting podcast recently. I'm not from LA, but I got hooked on this thing. And I heard people there saying, and interestingly enough, the same thing I've been saying for a long time about my lab, which is, what I would say is, I don't care whether you know how to program. I don't care whether you know anything about neuroscience. I don't care if you know machine learning. I can teach you all those things. I don't care if you know advanced math. Turns out that's hard to pick up later, but I did it. You can do it. I care that you will have an idea that I wouldn't have. That's it. That's your marginal value in the economy going forward, is what makes you different. So the more different you are, the more valuable. In that sense, it's great. But what does it take to create the kind of person that's willing to actually be honest about who they are, tell their boss the truth, come up with that idea, not just have it somewhere in their head, but make it real. So you're right that your avocation, the thing you have a passion around, the thing you'd be willing to make a sacrifice for is probably where your future is. But boy, we didn't raise people that way. No. And now we're gonna pull the rug out, I think, really fast.
Super fast.
And making that transformation is going to be critical. I got other things to say, but I should shut the fuck up again.
I have to say, my 8-year-old daughter, who is learning Scratch from MIT for programming, she's probably watching the live stream.
I will remember that. My 7-year-old daughter could possibly be doing the same thing. Shockingly enough, she may have heard these words already. You were fucking great.
I think what you were just talking about, though, is actually it's kind of at the core of something that we think a lot about, and obviously are trying to figure out ways to do something about it. Which is like, how do you actually go back to kind of traits and core assets or core ingredients of us as individuals, and then look at through opportunity through those lenses versus the lenses we look at it today, which are oftentimes very misaligned until way later and later in life, where you finally get the opportunity to have a moment to think about who you are, what you are, what you want to be, or what matters to you, and then you try to reassess and realign and find purpose and go back and get the skills and do all this stuff. And that's if you're fortunate. And so how do you from a system level, how do you redesign that? How do you give people the ability to engage in that assessment throughout their childhood, throughout work, throughout their careers, in a way that basically, kind of gives you a map, at least a trail. It's a really passionate topic, and obviously with some of the technologies that we play with, like we can measure a lot of things that would actually give us the ability to uncover that. And we could start to do kind of, neuroscience-backed games spatially that then start to uncover some of those things. And you could start to have an index of yourself and your natural trends or natural abilities. Then if you look at the entire field of work through that lens, that gets very interesting. And the scary thing, I think, the counter to that, is that's a pretty fringe concept to think about in most corporate America. And they talk about embedding continuous learning, but they talk about doing that through e-learning online courses that they give free subscriptions, not actual transformational kind of a way to relook at yourself. And they don't fund it. You know, so it's like, it's a lot of words. And it's a lot of like, we know that this is coming and we're really scared about it and we need to do something about it, but we're not gonna give L&D another dime. We're not gonna give HR another dime. And we're not gonna give them the tools that they need to actually solve these things. And instead, we're gonna basically shift the money to some innovation AI project that we think is gonna be a solution that was probably oversold and won't deliver.
Oversold AI, is that possible?
And so like, that's the confluence of issues that have to be really like, you know, unpacked. And you know, I was hopeful that that was gonna happen in the private sector and in industries that basically were otherwise screwed. And you know, we're pushing, but it's not happening at least from what I can tell, it's not happening at the government level in this country. And so, you know, the question becomes is where does that happen? And I don't have a view on it. I don't have enough data. But it's like it seems like that's the conversation that should be a little bit more of the focus.
I think it's happening increasingly through public-private partnerships. So I think the future of education and training in America is not going to be just solely responsibility of local governments to teach people from K through 12 and then push them out to, let's say, community colleges or tertiary universities. I think it's going to be very much a collaborative experience between the public and private sector. And I have seen a couple good examples of corporations actually putting a lot of money to help train their workforces for the future. The key point here is that A, it's not cheap, and B, it takes a long time. So even these kinds of transformations will take a long time, and how people evolve to actually get those skills in a short amount of time is really critical. I'll give you two examples that I've seen at corporations. Walmart, one of my friends is the head of people at Walmart, they spend $3 billion on their Walmart academies. And as you can imagine, Walmart is a very retail-heavy environment. Their Walmart academies are designed to teach basic hard skills like basic business skills, basic math skills, and some soft skills like customer service. And if you go through this program, that usually lasts between 2 to 6 weeks, then you're able to get a bump in salary per hour. So that's one way that one company is helping one particular sector. And then another company is, for example, I'm not working for these companies, so I'm not sponsored by them. This is just telling you what I've learned. Another company, Toyota, has seen that they actually are lacking in finding technicians to do manufacturing in automotive plants. And so they've created this really amazing program called the Advanced Technician Manufacturing Program, where they actually go into middle schools and high schools in Kentucky and get kids excited about STEM and then sponsor them for the next 6 to 8 years through community colleges and help pay full price for their associate's degrees and then get them into advanced training programs. So there are examples of companies who are figuring out what they need in their workforce and saying, the local school district's not doing it, then what do we as a company do to make sure that we kind of get that workforce? So I think the future of this is really gonna be a public-private partnership in America.
Why don't we keep going?
I have a new mic. You know, one of the topics that's inextricably linked with future of work, which I'm surprised has not come up yet, you all, is universal basic income. And I know we'll have some colorful commentary on that, hopefully kid-friendly. Joe, why don't you kick us off? What do you think about UBI?
you know, it's... I'm a big fan of Andrew Yang. Spent a summer in Alaska and working in a cannery, living in a tent, and the locals got a check there, like from the oil companies. And it's like, why? Like, but just because. And if you think about it, it kind of makes sense because the middle class on a current trajectory, it's not likely to change that much. Middle class is going away. And if things continue the way they are, there will be winners and losers, and there will be fewer winners and more losers as a result of sort of this, automation. And so it kind of makes sense. If you're a worker paying taxes, as a result of your salary or your income, and then that gets replaced by a robot, or physical or virtual, then that robot should kind of pay taxes too. Maybe not as much, I don't know. But the concept carries across. Otherwise, the tax base goes away, and then we have much larger problems. So, and then sort of this redistribution of wealth, which, you know, I know that's socialist, but it's like, whatever. I mean, we're already fairly socialist. So it's, and when you do a, I don't want to get political, but it's like, you know, tax break to the wealthy, hello, you know? So I think there's something to it. I don't think it should be dismissed out of hand. There are those who will say, oh, you're getting paid to do nothing. You're going to lose the motivation to work. It's sort of like, I was in a medical facility taking the elevator down on a Friday at like 6 p.m. And this lady got on, she was in her scrubs, and you know, probably in her early 20s. And I said, oh, can I have a good weekend? She's like, oh no, I'm going to my other job now. And you know, it's like, it's these people have 2-3 jobs just to, like, you know, sort of keep their heads above water. And she was like happy. And I kind of, it was a slap in the face for me, like, man, I you know, you kind of, like, if you don't see it, you forget about that. Mm-hmm. So, I think there's probably a place for it. I don't know what the right answer is, but you know, Bezos doesn't need another zero at the end, you know? He just doesn't.
So universal basic income is a really intriguing idea. I think that there is a clear case to be made that in a society that can afford it, there are certain basic human dignities. Having food, having a place to live, having medical care. I'm all in. Is universal basic income the right way to deliver it? Yeah. Wonderful debate to be had, but I'm genuinely in with the human rights side of this argument. It is absolutely not a solution to the future of work problem,
yeah.
Not even remotely. Because the future of work problem is a purpose problem. Mm-hmm. And having, sorry, checking myself, having a crappy job is not a purpose. And when I say purpose, I get to study purpose. So you mentioned this idea of actually tracking these deeper latent qualities about people. Well, that's it. That's really what we're talking about. We're talking about people doing creative work in the world. We're talking about general cognitive ability, social skills, emotional intelligence, creativity-related skills, and metacognition. All the things you know how to do, I know how to program, I know how to do Adobe stuff, whatever that is, I can do SAP. None of that, one, will be meaningful 10 years from now, or is actually distinguishes you from the wide variety of people that can't seem to get a job in the exact same field. Silicon Valley is full of people that know how to program and can't get jobs, because that's not the magic ingredient. So in the case of universal basic income, what I'm generally worried about is we pay a bunch of people to go find their bliss. Well, they find it in binge watching a bunch of shows, occasionally going and doing a kind of crappy low autonomy job. And what you've got is a whole bunch of young men with a lot of free time on their hands and no sense of purpose, which is basically the recipe for every civil war ever. So I'm less worried about, you know, Skynet taking over than I am about what happens when social dysfunction and lack of purpose invades society. But I'll say that there's another element, because this ties very much into some of the questions about education and training, which is there's really two separate questions there also, which is, in the moment, do you happen to have a skill that we need for a specific job? But there's a much bigger question, which is, are you the kind of person that can use that skill to go explore the unknown? And in a world where jerks like us are building AIs that take away all of the boring rote work that make us all kind of inconsequentially the same, then again, what makes you special is what makes you different. Well, if you can't express that difference, if you don't have that emotional intelligence that allows you to disagree with people when you know you're right and your parents think differently and your friends, and if you don't have social skills, it turns out in our work when I was the chief scientist at Guild, social skills were just as predictive of the quality of code software developers wrote as it was of the sales volume of salespeople. It was maybe a little less common in software developers, but it was just as predictive when they had it. So we keep talking about the big problem, which is how do we have a world in which people have a real purpose that they build and bring into that world, but we keep on coming up with solutions for right now. How do we have enough people that can actually fulfill all of our programming jobs? How do we make certain no one's unhappy right now because they don't have the rent paid? Those are worthwhile transient problems to fix. But the big ones, UBI and skills-based education, do not address.
That's true.
I agree with her.
Yeah, I think Vivian hits the topic of purpose really, really on the nail on the head. I think UBI is a sexy topic in terms of, in the conversation, what do we do when people are unemployed, assuming everybody becomes unemployed? I think working hard is part of the American DNA. And when we take away incentives for people to work hard towards whatever goal they want to pursue, that creates incentives which are potentially not in line with how we've created the society. And so I think incentives really fuel the potential of humans to achieve, to create, to really maximize their perspective in life. And so I think it's really critical for us to think about how do we create incentives to make sure that everyone is reaching their maximum potential. And UBI sounds like a nice panacea in Silicon Valley to some of the major problems that we technologists have created, but I don't believe that that is the right solution as people think it to be. There might be some aspects of it that might be appropriate depending on how it's structured and for whom, but we really need to dissect and define what does that mean in terms of helping people who are transitioning into difficult roles and figuring out how do we create the right kinds of incentives to maximize human achievement, creativity, and potential.
I've got to say, actually, to connect something you just said and you said here, so the pitch that Amazon gave me to be their chief scientist for people was the best ever. Like, no one's ever gotten me to go actually fly and talk to people, but this was great. In 7 years, we will be a 1 million person company, and your job will be to make their life better. I've gotten a lot of fancy-smancy job offers. That's the only one that got me to say anything other than hell no. And so I flew up there, I met with everyone, and what became very clear is Jeff's definition of better was distinctly different than mine. There's a litany of things that have come out that they're being developed, you know, risk things that buzz when you reach for the wrong box, and AI to automatically discharge low productivity workers, another AI that wouldn't hire women, which that one I told them it wouldn't work, they built it anyways. The reason I'm bringing all this up is, arguably a very small number of companies. There's a lot of startups in the AI space, but a very small number of companies really control the AI infrastructure of the world. And Jeff owns one of them, and Larry and Jack and a variety of other people. I gotta tell you, Jeff is virulently anti-union. I have mixed feelings, but boy, they don't have mixed feelings at Amazon. Part of what they wanted me to build was a little AI propaganda system to make their logistics workers happily choose to leave after 2 years because they didn't want unions there. So I bring all this up because the tax the robots things is a strong economic argument behind it. But I've got to tell you, if in the end, a dozen people are essentially paying the predominance of the tax base in the United States, and at least one of them is Jeff Bezos, and I'm willing to bet his other friends, who largely think that they're all heroes in a Ayn Rand novel, they're our tax base. Pretty soon, they're gonna start thinking, God damn it, I can't go blue. They're gonna start thinking, why the hell am I paying for all these lazy bastards to not do any work? And they're gonna pull it out. So there's also a huge civil rights issue here, which is very possibly this kind of plutocratic artificial intelligence system is just fundamentally incompatible with civil rights. And the simple right to work, that to not get algorithmically redlined, is these are huge issues, and I don't think we're addressing those strongly enough either.
I just wonder if it's a timing issue of all of it. You know, I mean, at the end of the day, UBI conversation to me is just it's a question of do we have a timing issue that we're capable of actually solving, and if not, do we have to lean on something like that to basically try to stem off some of the other issues that would naturally result? And that's where you go, okay, we got to take a really hard look at this, because ultimately that's just a crutch that we're going to lean on for a period of time to go across from one side to the other in a best case scenario, right? In a worst case scenario, it's obviously, you know, a much bigger problem. And so does it have a place in the conversation? Absolutely. But it's a different conversation. It's really about all the other systems that we're talking about, and are they capable of supporting that conversation from a regulatory, a civil rights, and all the other supporting systems that also have to change? And can that all happen in concert in enough time so that we can stem off the bigger issue? And that, you know, if you were to look at at least the U.S., I would say the answer is probably no. And therefore, we probably need to look really hard at that crutch for at least a period of time. And then the question is, you know, how quickly can you get it off? You know, how quickly can you pull it out? And that's to me, the much bigger challenge. And it kind of gets trivialized into a very, you know, kind of policy-based kind of economic discussion when really it's not even, probably, that's probably not even the conversation being had, or should be being had.
There's the notion of conditional basic income as opposed to universal, where it's not, you just don't get it, you know, which aligns with incentive. I mean, it's like you need to do something, right? Mm-hmm. But then it starts to look kind of like welfare.
It becomes very complicated. And again, let me put it this way. Arguably, the global creative class represents somewhere between 1 and 300 million people, which sounds like a big number, except it's kind of a rounding error in a population of 8 billion people. So what does it take to pull as many people into that creative class over the next 10 years as possible? I agree, public-private, simply because I don't think anyone actually has anything together to make that kind of, I mean, my goal is 1 billion people. And you'll notice I'm still talking about a minority of people in the world. It should be 8 billion, but it isn't. We're not gonna get our act together in time. And so if it ends up remaining roughly the same size, I mean, some of this is just right on the surface. Roz Chetty, an economist at Harvard, had this piece of work just last year, got a lot of press, went by the title of Lost Einsteins. Just in the United States, he found kids, educationally matched kids from wealthy families, were 10 times as likely to get a patent in their lifetime, not than kids from poor families, but kids from middle-class families. A kid from a wealthy family in the lowest math quintile is slightly more likely to get a patent in his lifetime than a poor kid from the highest math quintile. Imagine if you could shift those numbers around, what that world would look like. But it's not easy. If it were easy, we'd have already solved that problem. And my big fear here is with things like UBI and quick fix, reskilling programs, we're saying this is gonna be easy. Six months, and then you'll be able to tweet about this. And if you can tweet about it, if you can tweet about it, it's not a solution.
Is that why you didn't accept my friend request?
I didn't. I have no idea. I loathe social media with a passion.
Yeah, it'll blow.
All right. So I think we have time for one more panel question, and then we'll open up to the audience, so get your questions ready. We covered a lot of ground. My last question is, let's look forward, like way, way into the future, because obviously, I think we're in consensus that it's going to be a rough, you know, 10, 20 years or so. But let's look to the year 2045. And what do you think work looks like in the year 2045? Let's start with you, Kian.
I think we'll still be working. I think the way we work will be different. Look back 30 years ago, 1989. People still work, but they use different technologies to communicate with each other. They all went to the same office. Now we're working quasi from home, remote. We're using different kinds of technologies. You fast forward to 2045. We'll be using different kinds of technologies to communicate with each other, and we'll have autonomous vehicles taking us increasingly around from home to work. So the way we work will be at different locations, and real estate will really matter very differently than it does now in terms of commute times. I just like to say that I think, you know, as if you have kids now, or you're going to have kids soon, and you want to help them prepare for 2045, the best thing you can do is really help them figure out the soft skills of how to develop really strong interpersonal relationships and communication, and how to make them increasingly more human in a world where 2045 will be a integration of man and machine.
My turn. So let's see. So 2045. I would like to believe that we've really worked, for 20 years on the purpose problem, and that people are looking at opportunity through a different lens, and they're charting their life through that lens. I think there's a lot of interesting data around the half-life of skills that indicates that we're going to basically work, 20 or 30 different, careers by today's definition over a course of a life. So you have to you basically go from kind of a plan to an iterative approach at everything you do. And so how that actually looks day to day is something we think quite a bit about and try to think about how do we start to put the systems in place to empower that. One side of if you just follow the trends is people will basically be picking up more and more complex work, but in a more gig-like fashion. Another thing that we've seen, which is interesting for LA, is the things that we historically thought you had to be inside of a big company to pull off. Will actually be able to be assembled, in a better fit for purpose fashion, in the kind of the Hollywood model. So really complex projects that basically come together with people who are aligned with purpose and actually have the skills to pull off something that's actually really difficult to do, and for a short period of time. And so that sounds like that could be, having lived that life, I can tell you it's a really fun life. So maybe that's something that actually puts us down this creative angle, and starts to fulfill some of these other themes that we've talked about in a way that stems off some of the other concerns.
So the future of work is best boys and gaffers.
Yeah. But I don't know what they're building.
Ah, yes.
Yeah. I don't know who they're serving.
There you go.
Yeah. But yeah. So I think that could be a couple interesting trends.
Cool. Hollywood model, Vivian.
So I'm not a futurist, and the one thing I can, 2045, 10 years from now, I don't know what the world looks like. But that's information too. If I said to someone, an economist or a financial analyst, the 10-year economic outlook looks really uncertain, they wouldn't say, well, screw that, we can't do anything then. Or they wouldn't do what we're doing in the future of work, which is policymakers saying, no, just predict one future. Mm-hmm. Tell me the one skill everyone ought to know in that future 10 years from now. We're going to train all 50 million kids in the United States to do that. If in 10 years the vast majority of code isn't written by machines, I will be shocked. And yet, this seems to be one of the major prescriptions
grace.
Of every future of work policy paper I've ever read. Teach everyone that program. What a load of... Yeah, so... but that's the thing is, That isn't what the economist does. The economist does, oh, says it's uncertain. All right, I'm going to put uncertainty into my model. I'm going to come up with an investment strategy that says, let's invest in a robust way that deals with the uncertainty. Ironically, under certain conditions, it actually might make your investment strategy even more precise. So what does uncertainty mean for the future of work? Well, we've kind of talked about this already. What is the solution to an uncertain future? It is someone that can figure out for themselves what they should be doing. It's someone that has creativity. It's someone that has social and emotional skills. I'm going to pull myself out here. I run this crazy thing called Socos Labs. By design, it doesn't make any money. My life has been very good to me, and so money flows into it. Okay, thank you for clapping for that. Feel free to make my life better for me. So what we do with that money is that people call us up and they say, my child has a life-threatening egg allergy, or my child has 500 seizures a day, or over the weekend, my son can't enter REM sleep. Like, boy, I've never come across that one before. And we do work in education, and we do work in workforce and inclusion. Boy, talk about an intractable problem. All these different spaces. And if we think we can make a unique difference with just a crazy mad science project, let's try something no one's ever tried in this space, then we do it. And we do it entirely for free. I pay for everything. And then we give it all away at the other end. And it makes me no money. It spends all of my money, literally. I hope the world's a better place for it. That's what I want the future of work to be. Mm-hmm. People being able to do what they think is right. The thing that they have to do, the thing they have to sacrifice for. They're willing to pay to make it happen. I have the good fortune of being able to indulge in such a life, and I've got to say, it is the greatest job in the entire world. Everyone should have my job. So, 2045, put me out of a job. Steal it from me.
Yeah, there you go.
All right, closing thought, Joe.
That's wonderful. So by 2045, you know, obviously the singularity will have happened. And obviously. So what that means is, and this is not new, that over the years, like the amount of work that we spend during the week has been decreasing. It will continue decreasing. And we'll figure out how people can still lead, you know, sort of decent quality of life lifestyles. And it's what AI is going to allow us to do is basically what's really important. I mean, I think the term live-work balance will cease to matter. Work doesn't have to mean you're not living. It's just going to be living. And we get to actually do what matters, caring about other people, as opposed to, worrying about more transactional things, whether someone's breaking a rule or whatever. It's going to be much more positive. Humans alone have this ability to empathize and care and be creative and have imaginations, and that it's AI is going to allow us to do more of that. And we'll basically become a much more loving society.
Send them love. All right. Oh, you guys, there's so much more we could go into for hours and hours and hours. So let's get some really good questions so that we can unpack some more. All right.
Yeah. All right.
Todd?
Ross.
Okay, so one of the things that I've noticed is if you can't see it, you don't believe it. And you can see when you work out your muscles in a mirror that it pays off. And with neuroscience, we're starting to be able to see when you're activating different parts of your brain. Now, sure, lots of things change in terms of productivity, but the human brain has the potential to be activated in more places. And I'm wondering how AI and education can actually, through data visualization or, you know, whatever. Like, there's got to be people in this room who are thinking about this.
So I was just...
She is.
I literally do this stuff. When I say I went to school to build cyborgs, It was a joke, but not nearly as much as you should let me near your kids. So I was just at a conference on neurotechnologies that was at MIT a week and a half ago. And I have a couple of startups in this space as well. So, you know, what you're alluding to is, can we use machine learning and AI to transform education, the aspects of parenting? And it turns out we run a bunch of philanthropic projects in that space. Which is to say, I'm a neuroscientist. If I want to change someone, I need to rewire their brain. And I've got two ways of doing it: rich, natural experiences. And yes, machine learning can play a role in delivering those kinds of experiences into people's lives, whether it's what we do with caregivers and little kids, or we're launching a new project for 20-somethings to kind of figure out how to launch their lives. Again, all giving it just away. But of course, there's another way to rewire people's brains. So I don't actually know when the singularity's coming, but I can actually. This is not futurism, to give you a rough timeline from when we will have people that are artificially smarter than other people, because it was a couple of years ago. So one of my startups that I work with has a little stim patch, and they are hardly unique in this world. It does alternating current transcranial stimulation along the midline theta, which you all desperately need to know. There will be a quiz later. And does anyone here remember the old Simon game where you push buttons and you had to remember? So those of you that are too young to remember, and those of you that aren't, you're my people. So in a room like this, you might be a little above average, but generally speaking, 5th, 6th, 7th length sequences, and it gets hard to remember what comes next. And it turns out, if you're a 9, that's a huge advantage. You'll earn $30,000 more across as a population level, actuarially. You'll earn much more. You'll literally live longer. It doesn't correlate strongly with happiness, but education, attainment, wealth. Some of these do. Purpose does. Purpose correlates strongly with everything. Do you want to make a better life? Go build a purpose for yourself. But working memory span has a lot of desirable attributes. We know causally how childhood household stress changes molecular development of the brain and permanently decreases working memory span. So now you can slap this thing on your head, and if on the old Simon game you were doing 7th length sequences, now you're doing 9. Just like that, for about 2 hours. You are literally smarter, because you could buy this product and stick it on your head. Turns out we're now exploring systems that can do creativity. Honesty, that's a weird one. Ask me about it later. So, you know, imagine an equalizer on your phone, except it's not for your music, it's for you. Attention, emotion, all these things. You got a preset, it's date night, you hit the preset, cognition goes way down. There is a bad romantic comedy in your future, and goddammit, you're gonna enjoy it. Emotion goes up, attention's up, but distractibility, you rebalance yourself. And that sounds like crazy nonsense, except none of it is.
Yeah.
And this is not coming, it's here and already being commercialized. Let me tell you, at MIT, there were a bunch of billionaire investors, a bunch of neuroscientists, and then a bunch of guys that were looking at your brains as the next greenfield. You want Facebook in your head? They're already in your head if you didn't realize it, but what about literally in your head? So we've got these two choices. I like the two-choice model of this. Yes, we can use machine learning to rethink education, make it experiential, make it not just lifelong, but day-long, like all the experiences. It's a project we're actually running, hopefully, with Sesame Workshop around that. But there's this other side of it, and that has a choice too. Is this a human right? Or is this a sweet 16 gift that wealthy parents give their kids? Because if it's the latter, then there's two kinds of humanity and we'll never go back.
There's also pushing, going back to like change in medium, right? So you're talking about augmentation, right? And there's delivery, right? So right now we're delivered data and we're delivered message through our applications and mediums that don't work well for us. We're not beings that are actually wired for that delivery system. So once you actually start to look at what kind of a spatial relationship to some of those things can do. So you mentioned data visualization. There was a project that we got asked to step into and help for cancer diagnosis, because they're basically measuring, they basically have diagnosis solved. The problem is it's not human readable. It's measured across 40 dimensions of protein sequencing, and when you look at 3D broadcasts across 40 dimensions, an average person can't be taught to read that. So they're like, well, wait a second, we don't have to think in 2D anymore. So how do we actually figure out a kind of a spatial language that allows us to read this kind of thing so that it becomes a bit more like an X-ray or something else that we can read? So there's a lot of things like that where we're gonna basically be able to kind of like, you know, I think through different presentation and different delivery, we'll be able to also hack ability in kind of different directions. Some of it may just be very simple, where it's just the way that the pretty pictures are presented to us, and we naturally, based on the way we walk through the world and the way we experience the world, things have natural meaning to us with no cognitive load to actually process that. So, you know, starting to look at how because there's the augmentation piece, and then there's just the delivery piece, like even the current systems that we use, and both of those are gonna start to happen, and that's where, like, I think you get to a sweet spot of like actually being able to fill different roles and build different career paths that we have a hard time fully imagining today because we haven't seen those delivery systems, you know, at scale.
I mean, it's interesting, you look at most hiring software, and I will throw my own companies in there, back in the day, it starts with a technical skill search terms. So I'm trying to find people. They've been talking about cognitive load. I'm trying to find people, mm-hmm. and yet I'm doing these Boolean search strings across technical language that the recruiter probably doesn't understand at all. What I should have is people. Mm-hmm. You know, it should be, I'm sure there is such a company now, but back when we were thinking about this, it should be Tinder for hiring, and you're like, I want these people and this kind of person, and, you know, I want Jeff Hinton, but affordable and interested in working on this project, and bam, you start to auto-populate this thing in the human space. You're thinking human, you're searching human.
And you just have a different tool that's actually helping you
accomplish Yeah, well, I mean, under the hood, it's massively hyper-dimensional, but the actual experience is a human one.
Yeah.
Okay, let's go on to another question. Do you got one, Todd?
Hi, my name is Marlon, lifelong learner, happy to be here. I really like that you brought up the issue of this being a civil rights issue, and it reminded me of Dr. King, 1963, March in Washington for Jobs and Freedom. Dr. King wrote a lot about the Economic Bill of Rights, about the government being the employer of last resort, but not of just last resort jobs, but of public good jobs. We have a major election coming up, and I'd like to know what you as experts think are things that we should be expecting from our next president, and do you think that we need to go back to Dr. King's vision for an economic bill of rights?
Our next president? You don't want to keep the orange gremlin who's wiping feces all over the White House?
Well, I don't think we should be thinking about our next president. I think our current president is thinking about that, but if we're going to wait till 2020 or 2024, that's too late. We need to be thinking about that stuff now. So we can't let that slide.
These are huge issues, and I got to say that I've been to DC twice in the last week, and I'm going back next week for a congressional summit. And again, people want quick policy things, really easy to articulate. They can tweet about them in 6 weeks, so that can be a win. In the US, I see the same thing in the EU, I see the same thing in the UK. It's different in Singapore, because they're not really answerable to anyone other than a revolt. So, you know, they tend to be this wonderful sort of paternalistic dictatorship, which is an interesting, crazy thing. So countries are different, but I think they're all trapped by the same thing, which is they tend to be very much in the moment, and this is a problem that plays out over lifetimes. I don't know that we have a good set of institutions. It's the worst of both worlds. The institutions are slow and obsessed with the moment. You know, you just watch the senators querying Mark Zuckerberg, not my favorite guy in the world, but, you know, it's hard not to root for him when these people are clearly barely understand, you know, 18th century plumbing, much less the internet.
Clearly like short-term, it's the culture, short-term, quick fix, long-term, and long-term for us is 4 years. And then the next guy can totally go the other direction. Where do you end up? Back where you started compared to, you know, other countries where it's like, okay, I'm president for life, and this is what we're doing.
But isn't it like a public conversation problem? Like, at the end of the day, I watched the 2016 election, and I was like, this is asinine, because no one's even having the actual conversation that needs to be had, and we're running on things that are you know, polarizing for other reasons. It's like, and then the same thing's happening in this whole future of work discussion, is you have kind of like popular ideas that start to trend, and then those become often and start to create a charter course that is a pulpit for somebody to play on, but the actual conversation is not really a national discussion in any sense. So it's like, how do you start to run and on policies, or start to suggest plans that people are like, you know, it's you're speaking another language at that level. And so until, you know, this room, great, you know, everybody reads about this stuff and can actually make some informed opinions about what they think is a legitimate argument or not around, you know, some of these policies. But on a national stage and in a overall public conversation, that's the scary thing, you know, to me. It's like, that's just not happening. And so how do you have any candidate that's going to go up and actually run on that? Because it's just not going to work. You know, they're running on a fundamentally losing platform, you know, if they actually bring that up in national conversation, because nobody cares. So, yeah, you have to escalate that, like, way up. Otherwise, it's just going to continue to...
I want to share the love here, because, you know, I said I feel like I've read every policy paper. I've certainly read all the major ones. Those aren't our government policy papers. Mm-hmm. That's McKinsey, yeah. Boston Consulting. It's World Economic Forum and the World Bank. And they're all saying... I mean, they could just photocopy one another. They're selling the same story. It's the trending thing, yeah, is driving the discussion. There are people, I mean, there genuinely, of course, are people that are thinking about this. But frankly, this is a particularly complex topic. We're talking about work, human choice, economics, machine learning and artificial intelligence. And civil rights, all of these things interacting. I will do one call out, not because I have any particular vested in him, but the one member of Congress who I have spoken with and I thought really at least wanted to understand this at a genuine level is Mark Warner. It's not because he's a Democrat versus a Republican. I think he just appreciates it's a complex story. And anyone that doesn't isn't actually solving the problem.
I think on this point of like, how do we solve this problem, we can't leave this to, let's say, a particular class of society to solve, like politicians, whether it's in Congress or Sacramento or wherever. I think this is such a large societal problem that it requires all of us to help solve. And what I mean by that is I ask you guys to think about how can you individually, when you go home in your own communities with school teachers or firefighters or whomever you work with, help them learn about this particular topic, get them aware of this so that we can start having this national conversation so that we have all hands on deck and not just some politicians in DC trying to solve this particular problem.
Let me say though, as we grab the next speaker, there was one paper I read that I like. It wasn't actually a policy paper, it was a survey by the New Americas Foundation, mm-hmm, that didn't ask a bunch of people in Venice and Palo Alto and Chelsea what they thought. They asked people throughout the country, and I guarantee you, given the responses, you would find this all over the world. And it was, I am not my job. Tell me what the rules are. Am I supposed to get a high school or a college degree? If I get that, I want a job for the rest of my life. It pays for my family, it gets me a house. I have my weekends and evenings free because that's my time. This is a wildly different story than what these more techno-utopianist vision of the future of work will be. And this is the majority of people on the planet are asking for something distinctly different. And here is where this becomes incredibly challenging, just at a simple moral choice level, which is, that's great, but it turns out people who are their job in the best sense literally live longer. They earn more money. They're actually happier. So who are we to decide who someone else should be? And yet you're confronted with the reality that if we let everyone make their own independent choices in ways that even they themselves would agree with, those choices aren't so great. So somewhere along the line, and in making no decision, turns out that's a moral choice too. You simply decided that whatever is going to happen in the future is going to happen, and somehow it's not your fault anymore, and it is. So I'm throwing it out there because it's not easy, and that's the sort of choice that gets made. Think of who you would vote for that could make that choice correctly.
All right, who's got a question? Ross? Okay.
Hi, I'm Jamie. So I actually wanted to say thank you for coming out. I think it's interesting that the title of this workshop is The Future of Work, because the future of work feels like the future of now for me. I actually have lost not one job, but two jobs to AI, and some, my job being automated. I did everything I was supposed to do. I have 2 degrees. I did well. I was successful in the job, but you know, there are forces beyond me that sort of like put me in a strange position. And the thing that was most shocking, and kind of what I wanted to sort of like provide and then ask a question about, was a little bit of qualitative data, because we haven't really talked explicitly about that. And the thing that was a really good lesson for me in both those experiences is that when you lose a job, not once but twice, your sense of belonging really shifts. And that is actually the biggest lesson you endure, and it's the hardest one to figure out and navigate. And so I think that's something I just was sort of thinking about. And so I guess the question I had for you is maybe a little bit more of a personal question. Have any of you on the panel lost a job specifically because of AI?
Do you mind if I ask just what the broad fields were that you were in?
Yeah, it was advertising, so programmatic advertising.
So my life is interesting because it came in two different tranches, we might say. One of which, I've never had to interview for a job in my entire life, and it's all swanky stuff that nobody automates. And the other half, I spent basically the 90s homeless. And no, I was not put out of a job by AI, because back then it wasn't that kind of a thing. But I know what it's like to wonder where your next meal is coming from. And wonder how the hell you're going to make it another month. Not in your case living in a car, but I was. It changes how you look at the world when the world seems hostile. And you do everything right. And listen, you did everything right. There are 100 million people in India that did everything right. The whole reason they have a job is because they can do accounting cheaper than someone in London. You know, it's labor triage. You think they can do it cheaper than an AI can read a spreadsheet and do a risk assessment? So this is gonna spread. It's gonna spread big. And in some places, it will be devastating. There was a line from a British diplomat during the height of the latter part of the Industrial Revolution in the 18th century. He said, the fields of India are bleached white from the bones of weavers, because this wonderful thing in one tiny part of the world devastated the economy in the rest of the world for 200 years. And it didn't destroy lives. I mean, it destroyed everything. Africa and Asia were devastated by the Industrial Revolution. And you better believe, if you did everything right, and they made that promise, that implicit promise to you, you go to university, you study hard, you get a high-paying job, you will have that for the rest of your life. That is we're breaking that social contract.
Yep.
It doesn't hold anymore. And I'm not saying that's a good thing, but I am saying that that's the deal. It turns out you signed a user agreement, a EULA, that you didn't realize. And they get to pull and change everything after the fact. You know, I gave an example recently. Anyone here seen Tuca and Birdie?
Yeah.
This is the town for it, right? So this is from, I think, Lisa Hannawalt, the animator for BoJack Horseman, now is doing her own series. And it's really stylized. I mean, her whole animal-headed people thing is like, now it's fantasy land. And that's amazing. And there's a whole army of people, I'm sure, working here in LA and probably South Korea, doing all of the individual animation work on that. Give it 10 years, max, and I guarantee you her job will be to come up with a script, write a couple of, sketch out a couple of key scenes, and Adobe put her out of a job, or will then fill in the entire rest of the thing. And she'll say, you know what, there's gonna be an alligator subway going in the background, and it'll add that in. And it'll all be in her style, which is the whole job, right? Being a staff writer or a staff artist is the style, sorry, that's my son's diabetes AI, is the staff writer capturing that style. Well, guess what? That job goes away. Like, that job drives the economy of this town. And, you know, in 10 years from now, it may not be here. And there are going to be a lot of broken contracts. And the thing is, I don't know what the answer to that is. I actually think there's an amazing value in having people have to actually pay a price, show how passionate they are about something, that it really took work to make it happen. It's part of what I hate about social media is, anybody can throw anything out there, and it's all equally valuable, and it's impossible to see, well, who actually understands this problem or this question or this art form well enough to do the work. You know, the Hollywood may be ugly in how it decides who gets to express themselves and who doesn't, but it turns out that does also do some value in the world. And I think it would be kind of scary if just anyone could tell an AI, hey, I'm an artist now, and I want a bunch of bird people, and they're flapping naked in the wind. Well, this is her thing. But and then you just make it. You describe it, and it's there. And that may sound great. We're democratizing art. We're democratizing entertainment. Except it's not. It's garbage. Now all being run by an AI that probably just spits out largely the same thing for everybody. There's a real value in having you in the loop. Here's a commitment. Build technology that not only makes us better when we're using it, it makes us better than where we started when we turn it off again. Only build technology that actually makes people better. Stop substituting. Stop thinking, God, the way I'm going to become a billionaire is to put a billion professionals out of a job. And start thinking, how can I take a billion people and transform their lives? Build a superpower. Like, every day, go out and build a superpower. That doesn't help you, and it doesn't change anything about the economic trends of the last 30 years, because this has been going on long before AI came along. The overwhelming trend is deprofessionalization. And if we don't figure out a way to deal with that, and deprofessionalization, this isn't a mistake. This would get really wonky, so I'm not gonna go into it, but you look, I do economic modeling as well. So you look at the elasticity of substitution for AI and human labor and the sweet spot for the productivity curves of those, and it's not taking the most elite performers and augmenting them with AI, it's taking the people that were just below the line and have less wage power and augmenting them to just be able to do the job. Because then I can hire 10 people instead of the one really expensive doctor, and I get higher productivity. Now, 20 years from now, it'll really suck. Because it'll just be the Jiffy Lube economy for everything.
Yeah. Yeah.
But sorry, I've gone on way too long. But I don't have a happy ending to that story.
All right, we've got two more questions. I think Todd has one.
Yeah, we got one right here.
Thank you. So you're talking about people becoming superheroes, but we didn't really touch on one of the biggest pieces of that, which was GDPR and all of these companies freaking out because all of a sudden they have to be a little bit more ethical about how they've collecting their data. And I have kind of a twofold question, I guess, because one piece of it is how do we didn't really touch on how we change these systems of future work, which to me is like making flat systems, not hierarchies. And you're talking about people finding their own superpower. Well, they need to be able to find the collect data and look at it of themselves. We have no mechanism to do that whatsoever. And so you're talking about people going out and finding, like, what, are they gonna go buy a self-help book? Mm-hmm. That's not helpful, mm-hmm. right? Like, people are still making self-help books and people are still ordering them off Amazon. Meanwhile, Amazon's like, how do I make you, like, grab this box right now and, like, zap, right? Mm-hmm. It's like, we're not talking about how we're actually gonna make people into those superheroes. And to me, I'm interested in how do you see AI in the current state where literally you have no mechanism for holding onto your data, and even if you did, it doesn't matter because it's non-transferable to anything else. What about that piece? Because the future of work to me, where we're letting all of this surveillance happen, is like the reason why we're like, yeah, let's put a camera in my alarm clock. That seems normal, right? And it's like, it's not normal, but it's like, it's normal because it happened at work. It's normal because we like let everybody watch us at work first, and then we brought that home. So how do we start to like actually give people autonomy so that we can have a future of work where people have purpose?
It may shock you to know I have an opinion about this.
I was hoping so.
I'm going to let my panelists respond.
I think there's two really interesting sides to what you're just saying. So on the corporate side, one of the things that we're in the middle of experiencing like every day right now is the tools we're delivering actually give the ability to actually, you know, generate more accurate data as to your own skills, natural abilities, all this stuff. And because of GDPR, companies are saying, we don't want it. We don't want the liability, we don't want whatever. So it's like, wait a second. So you need to solve this problem. You actually have a way to potentially help and give your employees the data that actually then empower them to solve it, but you're caught in the liability trap of what that might mean for you, so you're not gonna do it. That's one side, right? The other side is, obviously, I think that's potentially the next gigantic, you know, monolithic, potentially, and scary in a lot of ways, tech company, right? Like, I think there's gonna be basically, if we make the assumption that some of the things we talked about are gonna happen and you actually want to align with purpose, you wanna have a better measure of yourself, you wanna understand yourself in ways that you don't today, you wanna look at opportunities through a different lens, you're gonna have to fundamentally have access to that. And so that by itself is a huge value proposition. But the question is for what, right? And that's where, like, you know, what do you want to do with that? Like, to your point, right now, anything you want to do with that data is relatively trivial, but when it becomes non-trivial and it's actually about charting that course and charging up the mountain in a way that is aligned with some of those things, then it provides real value, and then people in mass would obviously get very interested in it, but.
Just following up to that, it seems to me like people are like scared from the liability, right? So then how do we get people to ask better questions? Because privacy by design is just asking better questions. Like, are you over 21? Not like, hey, where do you live, pretty girl? What year were you born and what's your eye color, right? So how do we, I guess, so how do we change the questions?
I gotta say one thing here is, I don't think there's going to be a unilateral solution.
Yeah.
Right, it's in these companies' vested interest to take ownership of much data they can. Liability, legitimately aside, these are static laws that don't adapt as quickly as business models and AI does. And so this stuff transforms very quickly. And so I have this thing I call the Lark's Vomit Theory of Entrepreneurship. So this is the old Monty Python bit, the Wizzo chocolate assortment. Again, if you're not old enough, just...
nod.
In this case, it's a progressively more disgusting assortment of chocolates with this constable interrogating the vendor. And they get to this one ram's bladder cup. So that's, they fly in this ram's bladder from Iraq and they whip it into a fondue and then lovingly garnish it with lark's vomit. And the constable responds, lark's vomit? Where does it say anything about lark's vomit? And he says, it's right here and the ingredients after monosodium glutamate. And he's like, it should have a big warning label on it, lark's vomit. And the constable responds, but our sales would plummet. So I don't know if anyone remembers this from a little while ago, but there was this company called Unroll Me, and their whole thing was a free plugin that would, you just hit a button and it would unroll you from these subscription services. And then it came out, shock of all shocks, that they were reading your email and targeting against it. And the CEO responds, what did they think we were doing? How did they think we were making our money? So I have a pretty strong feeling, like if you put your monetization strategy as a banner at the top of your website and your sales would plummet, maybe you're not doing something right.
Yeah.
And you know, this holds from a lot of big companies and a lot of small ones. But expecting them to change, you know, we've got a capitalist here, and it turns out capitalism has been pretty good to me, too. We also live in an America where that's the balance of power idea. Like, the framers were the original behavioral economists. Let's take real people in the world making the best decisions that real people make, and rather than idealizing them. In this case, I think we need a balance of power. And it's not government against industry. Each of them has a stake, but could go run amok on their own as well. So again, I've talked way too long. If you want to chat about one possible idea, not a magic fix, but one vision of it, there's this idea of data trusts, where people can collectivize data together. You can have different communities of data trusts that operate under different structures. Trust is a well-known legal entity. It's been around for hundreds of years. These people are beginning to build these things. They need their own infrastructure. So the thing that we're talking about, could you collect your own data and do something useful with it? I hacked my son's diabetes equipment. Turns out it broke several federal US laws. And I built the first ever AI to treat diabetes for my son. It turns out you can do whatever you want to your kids. Don't worry, he's gonna be good to you. But in this case, I'm pretty empowered. I've built a lot of things like that. What am I gonna do? Am I gonna build an AI? We're collaborating, for example, right now, again, cross my fingers, with the ACLU on building a system. There's a new movement, calling it AI is really pushing it, but using algorithmic systems to make judgments, for example, about bail and parole hearings. As far as I'm concerned, that's an expert witness, but it turns out it's an expert witness you don't get to cross-examine, and you don't get to bring your own expert witness. So we thought, okay, we'll build an expert witness for the defendant to be able to go in and say, no, actually, it turns out my client is not at risk, and here's why. But people aren't gonna be able to build that sort of thing for themselves or necessarily collect their own data or create great data stories out of that stuff. But what if we collectivize that? And people like the ACLU anyone, the Urban League, I was just there yesterday, anyone that actually wants to invest in giving people a better life, which means building the stuff and supporting the infrastructure to run it, can run it. And then it isn't that the companies own our data, they have to interface with these things. And that may sound ludicrous right now, but it doesn't have to be.
No.
We could completely transform the way this stuff works. Saying that it has to be the way it works right now is simply because a couple of young men moved really fast before anyone thought hard about this stuff and grabbed a ton of terrain. And it means we have a nice auditorium as a result. But that isn't how we should let brains get decided or civil rights get decided. We can reframe this conversation.
Time for one more, are we done?
One more on the other side, but hey, obviously, this is an amazing conversation, right? Yeah. And we know you all have questions. We all know you have questions and everything. So if the panel allows it later, we would love to do another live forum or just another video type forum in the future, maybe this month, maybe next year, where we have this conversation again and again, but where more people can ask questions, right?
Sure.
But right now, our last question will be on the other right. Thank you.
This is on. Hi. So I have a question. You know, you mentioned about like the creative economy, and given how like algorithmic systems, and how we say that a robot and or AI can help us and not necessarily replace jobs. So given with emotional intelligence, what makes us different? Humans, what differentiates us? It's the value we bring is creativity and emotional intelligence. So I'm just wondering, because I've seen software out there of live rendering platforms that were creating art. Like they were creating collages. I've also seen some that were creating projections based off of sensors that were doing like dance movements. So it just begs to differ the argument about creativity. And also with emotional intelligence, there are platforms out there that are measuring sentiment. So I'm just wondering, do you really believe that? Will there come a time where it's going? I'm not necessarily replacing. I just want to know your thoughts about the topic of emotional intelligence.
So the key word is measurement. What are you measuring?
Or what I mean by this is the whole thing of versus a human and a computer. A computer could do it better. So what makes us human?
You're measuring humans. You're measuring humans.
Correct. So, like, I guess could you expand a little bit more about emotions or about
let me,
art and creativity.
And I'm going to keep this sweet because there are other valuable opinions here. And I have not, I've been selfish. But let's take AlphaZero, created by a subsidiary of this company or its a holder. It beats, trivially beats the best human Go players. It trivially beats the previous best computer Go player. It doesn't understand anything about Go. It will play Go if the game is Baccarat. It'll play Go if the building's burning down around it. You know, it's really fascinating to study, for example, the OpenAI's game playing systems, and of course, DeepMind also has these amazing game playing systems that, again, beat some of the world's best human players in these very human places. And it's fascinating to really study what they do and how they differ from the way humans play. We can do the same thing in the creative space, look at these you know, dreaming models and sketch models, or go way back in the day for me and look at these style engines that can sort of learn basic style renderings and then play them out. You know, they're massive statistical engines, and I'm not saying that our brain isn't, but there's some substantial difference. You know what I think the next big thing in artificial intelligence is causality. God, we gotta get away from these giant correlational engines that do not understand anything about the world. But in your case, are these things artistic? You know, for me, I guess I'm making a philosophical statement, which is that art comes with intention and meaning. And these systems can explore really interesting extrapolations of statistical trends in their data. But to say a system that mixes the top-level hierarchical structure of Van Gogh with the low-level hierarchical structure of your kid's cartoon sketch and creates, you know, starry teddy bear is to really misunderstand, I think, what art is. So in the hands of an artist, maybe these tools are really powerful. But if we invest them with the idea that they're going to create art for society, you are going to find art that is going to stagnate and look very much the same for a long time. Not because it's not possible for AI to do more, but that's where we're at right now.
But that's not really, I mean, that's just not, I mean, if you look at art, I mean, that's just kind of not how it progresses, right? Like, I mean, you basically, you get a new tool, the tool unlocks an entirely new dimension of thinking, and it transitions into something that we didn't expect or we didn't even think of before. And we've done that dozens of times. So I don't, you know, to think that that's gonna stop, like that's where this, that's what's scary. Like that to me, if that actually stops or that trends in a direction where like we don't care or nothing new is happening, then we're screwed. Then it's like, okay, wait, this is the superpower that we hold that we just decided is not something we are willing to exploit. But I don't, you know.
I mean, I said this earlier, which is I think in some ways our superpower is our ability to explore the unknown.
Yeah.
And I think the art is one of the fundamental explorations of the unknown. Maybe we might hope that Hollywood would explore a little deeper some of the time, but it tries. And that only goes away if we let it. But there's always trends in those directions.
I think one of these points of these super stories or superhumans, what distinguishes us from every other living being on this planet is our ability to tell stories and to communicate learnings through generations. So is AI gonna create algorithmic art that is interesting? Yes. Is AI going to tell a story like a human will? And that is what will distinguish our ability to create something genuinely beautiful in the future, is our ability to tell stories. And I think that is a very big distinction.
Well, great questions from the audience. And I don't know if we solved the future of work, but well, we covered a lot of ground. And let's see, the singularity is already happening. Pool robots are a thing, but they should be taxed. The economic bill of rights needs to be happening already. For 2045, maybe don't learn how to code, but do find your purpose and practice being creative and telling stories. All right. We got it.
So done.
Thank you all.
That would feel good, but you got it all figured out.
Exactly.
High fives.
Exactly.
High fives.
Thank you. What an amazing panel. Thank you for all your questions, your time, your generosity. There's about, I think, 250 seats actually in this space. I think 247 actually is the exact number. It's a weird odd number. Who knows how many people actually were standing up. But what an amazing group. You all came out on a Thursday night to have a conversation about the future of work. Whether you have a job now or you want a job later, I mean, we're all in this together. But please let me, help me thank our amazing panel. Now, technically, we get kicked out around 10, but there's definitely some more drinks outside. Please meet each other. This is your community. We want you to get the most out of it. If you have the opportunity, please help support us. If everyone in this room gave $5, we still would not even meet our threshold for this event, just to give you guys perspective. So anyways, this is all on credit, and we here want to make sure that we do these events again. We'll be back here on June 20th talking about creating a fair and ethical future. We hopefully will see you back. Thank you so much for your contribution, your support, your time. Please get home safe, and we'll see you here next time.